Hello, dream catchers, and welcome to part two of our two-part series with K.O. Brady. K.O. agreed to stay with us a little bit longer, and I really, really appreciate her for doing that. There's just so much information that she just kind of poured into this discussion. And so I just wanted to make sure that you guys sponge it all up and just really hear from a person who is very accomplished and has, to some degree, been where you've been or are. So we're going to continue our discussion. KL, thank you so much for coming back. Who is this person?
SD Sky.
SD Sky. Let's talk about this FBI spy thriller series that you've been working on.
Right.
Now, this is book number...
That's three.
Book number three.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That's the latest. That's the latest and greatest, The Shadow Syndicate.
How did we get to spy thrillers?
So, what happened, you know, I'd been writing romantic comedies, so I think I got through The Bum Magnet, Got a Right to Be Wrong, which was the follow-up. I had to do those for my contract with Simon & Schuster. And then I wrote a couple of young adult books. Well, what happened is my mother passed away, and I didn't feel funny anymore. You know, I really felt like I lost my sense of humor altogether, and it was very difficult to write something funny. Mm-hmm. And it felt dark. You know, I was just kind of in a dark place. But I wanted to write. And so spy thrillers are darker. It was a place where I could really use my writing to write something darker where I didn't have to be funny. Well, they ended up being kind of funny.
But well, you have that sense of humor
that
you bring into your work, so that's...
Yeah, even though I don't feel funny...
Right.
If you are, you are.
The characters
they pick up on that. So so that's what happened is I started that. Now... I had a 20-year career in intelligence, and I spent 12 years at the FBI, and I worked in counterintelligence. So one of the things when I was there is that, I was like one of the few black people in FBI counterintelligence, as you can imagine. There's not a whole lot of black people like chasing spies. Mm-hmm. But there was a black female FBI agent who I greatly respected and really just admired. And she always stayed in my mind, you know, always. I was like, somebody ought to write a book about you. Mm. And she ended up going like to the highest heights of the FBI. I won't mention her name because... But she ended up doing really well. Well, anyway, so I left the FBI in 2003. Fast forward to 2012, something like that. 2013, somewhere in there. When I was in that dark place, and this is when the book, I woke up with the name J.J. McCall.
Wow.
And I was like, that is the agent's name, J.J. McCall. And then from there, the story just started kind of evolving. And so I ended up writing a spy thriller. I did not know anything about writing spy thrillers. I really, it's a completely different process from writing, like in terms of the complexity of the story. Like I didn't get that when I was writing my first book, of course. Mm-hmm. You know, points of view, things like just a whole lot of different things that I did not understand really how you had to execute this really well in order for it to work for a thriller. Mm-hmm. So so I wrote the book and then it went through a lot of revisions and a lot of changes. And then I had to go through an FBI pre-publication process because they have to review everything that I read, even though I'm out of it. So. Mm-hmm.
That's an interesting point, though.
Yeah, they have to. Yeah, so everything I write, they have to review and approve and make sure that I haven't bled any of my career into my books.
Right.
So that's what that's about. And then I ended up publishing it, and I actually sent it to my editor, at Simon & Schuster, and they were going to pick it up, but I decided that I just wanted to do it independently because I wanted the freedom to just kind of take it wherever I wanted to take it, and I didn't know if that was going to fit.
That's a very, very entrepreneurial move, and you probably didn't see it as a in that way. It was more so, you know what, this is something that I know I can do on my own, something I want to do on my own, and you made that decision. Whereas, you know, some authors signed by a major, you know, they want to push that over there too. But I think that that's pretty awesome that you did that. Outstanding, actually.
Well, you know, it was for me creatively, mm-hmm. right? Like, I mean, that's the driver. Mm-hmm. Anything that hampers that or makes me feel constricted, then I don't get the same joy out of doing it. You know mm-hmm. what I mean? Mm-hmm. And so I just felt like if I'm going through, especially pocketbooks at the time, was romance. So it would have really kind of played up the romance part of it and played down the spy thriller of it. Yeah. And what I really wanted to get across to people was that, hey, there are black spies in the U.S. intelligence community doing all the things that you see the Jack Ryans doing, you mm-hmm, know? Mm-hmm. No, there's black Jack Ryans there doing that work, being really, really being successful
good.
At
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
And so I really wanted to put a black female in that role and have her be serious. I didn't want it to be about a romance, but I wanted people to take her as a serious professional who's really just great at what she does. Mm-hmm. And that's because I had a role model to kind of use as an inspiration for the characters.
Now, who are you reading?
Oh my gosh.
Who are you reading, and who inspires your writing? What other authors?
So I have to say, probably almost every contemporary black author mentions Terry McMillan, but it's truly Terry McMillan for me. Mm-hmm. So I was a huge Toni Morrison fan, right? Mm. Huge. But I never thought I could write like Toni Morrison. Toni Morrison is the reason why I never thought I could write. Right.
Oh, wow.
I mean, because I just know I don't have that prose. You know what I mean? I loved it. I just put it, you know, on a pedestal. It's like, that prose is just so beautiful. I am not a poetic person. I'm a, you know, I write jokes. I'm funny. I don't write prose. You know what I mean? So I thought I just couldn't be an author. And then I read Terry McMillan, mm-hmm. and she brought it home for me.
Yeah,
You know, it was like, I could do this. Mm-hmm. You know, and not like she made it easy, because she's an awesome writer.
Yes.
But at least the voice, it made me think your voice could probably work as it is.
Yeah.
And you could tell your stories in your voice, and that's okay. Mm-hmm. You don't have to be Toni Morrison. You can be K.O. Brady. So that's, she was really a huge inspiration. Mm-hmm. So, and in terms of what I'm reading, really what I read now is a lot of biographies.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so I've got Sheila E.'s biography. I've read Steve Jobs. Like, mm-hmm. I've read like a whole bunch of, you know, just different biographies. And for me, what I like to learn is what I like to read is the creative process. Like, how did you evolve from figuring out that you like the drums to what kind of energy did you put into it, and mm-hmm. what motivated you to stick it, mm-hmm. stick to it when you had all these obstacles going against you? Mm. Like, it's those stories that really give me energy to keep going, because sometimes you can hit walls and you feel like, really, should I keep doing this? Mm-hmm. I mean, I quit like 3 times a year. You know, I quit writing. Seriously, it lasts, you know, sometimes it lasts a day or two. Mm-hmm. But honestly, I do get to those points where I think, you know, is this worth it? Is it really worth it? And then, mm-hmm. yeah, it is. Mm-hmm. It's all, you know, almost 10 years later, right? Yes, I've come to the conclusion that it is. It's definitely worth it.
Yeah.
But sometimes you do need that reminder. So those biographies and things like that, and I watch a lot of documentaries, mm-hmm. things like that give me energy mm-hmm. to say, yes, keep pursuing, keep moving, you know. Because there's a lot of famous people out there who they were just one step away from giving up.
Yeah.
You know, if they hadn't stuck to it, they wouldn't have, you know, succeeded. So.
Yeah, yeah. So the biographies, the memoirs
yes.
are great inspiring stories.
That's the energy that I need right now. I don't read a whole lot of fiction right now.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to think. And when I do read it, it's usually like romance.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, so that's pretty much what I'm spending my time with.
Okay, okay. And last question. What advice would you give to young authors beginning their journey, starting their journey as a writer?
Oh, several pieces of advice. The first thing is just write.
Mm-hmm.
Don't talk about writing. Don't talk about publishing. Don't talk about, who am I going to find for an agent? No, don't worry about any of that. Just get words on paper. Because you can't sell a wish or mm-hmm. a dream. You can sell a manuscript.
Mm-hmm.
And the only way to write a manuscript is to get the words on the paper. And I find like a lot of new writers kind of get ahead of themselves, right? They are thinking about what happens after they're published
mm-hmm.
rather than thinking about how to get those words on the page so
yeah.
that they can so that they can actually have something to publish. I can't tell you how many times I've heard somebody say, so I'm on chapter 3 and I'm trying to figure out how to get published. I'm like, how do you get published? Is it right? Chapter 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14,
mm-hmm.
320. You know what I mean? That's how you get published. You know, asking that question at chapter 3 is what will keep you from not getting published.
Mm-hmm.
The second thing I would say is don't worry. Get your first draft out. Just get the words out of your head on the page. Do not try to make it pretty. Do not try to make it perfect.
Mm-hmm.
Don't edit yourself in that first stage. Just get the words out on the page. You can edit it. You'll have plenty of time to edit.
Right.
You won't do anything but edit after, you know, the first draft. But get the first draft out. And then the last thing I would say is, you know, use outlines and just give yourself a place to work from every day. Do not bind
and write
yourself.
Every day?
Write every day.
Mm-hmm.
Write something every day.
Mm-hmm.
I always write every day. I mean, I have to actually because my full time, you know,
mm-hmm.
my 9-to-5 job, I call it the 9-to-5. I have a 9-to-5 and a 5-to-9. Right? So, but my 9-to-5 job requires me to write every day. But I try to write creatively every day something, even if it's a page, even if it's just a paragraph. But even 10 words moves me forward in my next project more than writing nothing. So it's better to write something than nothing.
Mm-hmm.
So always write something. And you can always edit something. But if you don't write anything, you can't go back and edit it. So so that's my big thing. And don't be afraid of your creative process and using outlines. Like, don't think it's going to hamper your creativity. Don't bind yourself to the outline.
Mm-hmm.
Write it to keep yourself productive. Do not write it as a contract that you have to follow everything in it or you're going to break the contract to yourself.
Yeah.
So that's the big thing.
So, KO, your book, The 12 Days of Christmas, talk to us about what inspired this book. Now, this is one of your best-selling books.
It is. And it's a favorite of mine because I love writing Christmas stories. I
mm-hmm.
think I love Christmas stories above all others,
mm-hmm.
Just because of the season, and I'm a Christmas fiend. So,
mm-hmm.
the 12 Days of Christmas actually came. It was one of the few books that came. The title came to me before the actual story came to me,
and the characters,
and the characters.
Wow.
But I wanted a Christmassy type theme, and I just kept going through, you know, so many different iterations and stuff until I landed with this one. And I thought, well, it would be really interesting to kind of do one of the things I've been seeing a lot is misconnections. you know, on the internet, I've seen all these misconnection stories mm-hmm. where people are supposed to meet or they meet in passing and then they can't find each other again, things like that.
What do you mean, like a dating situation?
Yeah, well, if you look up misconnections, mm-hmm.
like Google misconnections.
Yeah. So what'll happen is two people will be in one place, and
okay.
they'll see each other, and they will they'll think there was a connection, but they're not sure.
Oh, okay, right? Gotcha.
So they go to these sites, the misconnection sites,
okay,
and they try to find that person to see if that person had the same connection that they had.
Wow.
So I was seeing things like that.
Okay.
And I thought about, and this idea came to me, it's a little different than that, but mm-hmm. but the idea behind this one is that just meeting somebody through a text message, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what happens is a stray text message brings these two characters together. So you have Gabby, who has she's broken up with her fiance. Her fiance texted a breakup during their wedding.
Oh, my goodness.
So she's, crushed. And it was a Christmas wedding.
Uh-huh.
So Christmas time has come around again, and she's, in the dumps.
Mm-hmm.
And so she thinks this is just going to be another crappy Christmas that she's got to get through when she gets this stray text message from somebody, and it intrigues her. The message intrigues her.
Mm-hmm.
So she actually replies to the message, and the message comes from this Dave, who she doesn't know. She only knows by Dave.
Mm-hmm.
And so they start carrying on this conversation through these text messages.
Mm-hmm.
And then they end up falling for one another. And so the texts evolve into a call. And they end up calling one another, but they decide that that they're just going to keep it as, they're not going to share it a whole lot of personal information and all this kind of stuff. They just want to keep it light because, you know, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So, but then they eventually agree to meet, except for the meeting doesn't happen.
A misconnection.
Right. So there's a misconnection. So then the question then becomes, you know, how do they find one another? Well, during one of their conversations, he dropped one little piece of information that he was moving and a piece of information that allows her to find the potential building that he's moved into.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a condo with 300 units.
Okay.
And so her sister is a real estate agent who can look up the tax records and see. So her sister does a search and finds how many Daves live in the building. And
mm-hmm.
there's 12 Daves in the building.
Mm-hmm.
So now without ever having seen this guy, they never exchanged pictures or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
So now without ever having seen this guy, she's going to try and find him. So that is kind of the start of how this story does.
So the title came to you,
uh-huh.
but the actual story, what was
came
it?
Came together in bits.
In know. Bits, in bits. And it was due to something that you saw about misconnections.
Yes,
it's like, okay,
yeah.
Look, this is a good theme.
Yeah,
this is something that
theme.
People can relate to.
Yeah, and it's very modern, right?
Mm-hmm,
it's a
mm-hmm.
very modern thing to happen, to fall for somebody over text messages.
Right.
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 It's
right.
a very modern thing.
And
so.
I can definitely see the movie in that. I do see the romantic comedy
yeah,
in that.
It's
for
hilarious.
Sure. Who is starring in that romantic comedy?
Oh
yours?
My goodness. I hadn't really even put characters to but it would be somebody young, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It could be
I see that Lopez girl playing that part of Gabby.
Yeah.
I could possibly see her.
It could be.
See her. Yeah, and of course, I'm thinking about this, her latest movie that's out. But yeah,
yeah.
I could see. Because she kind of plays those funny romantic comedy
yeah,
roles,
absolutely.
Too.
Yeah.
So, you know, one thing that I loved immediately about the book is the cover.
Yeah.
So, how much, well, you had full 100%
yes.
authorization
yes.
and approval.
Yes.
On this, but how did the idea of it? Did you just kind of talk to the designer, or did you give very explicit direction? Okay, this is what I want the cover to look
yeah,
like.
Yeah,
is that how it worked?
I gave very explicit instructions on what to do. And my first book, The Bum Magnet, right? It's a cartoonish
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
cover like this, And the idea actually came from the bum magnet, because the idea on the bum magnet is, like, there's all these hands. We couldn't put, like, a whole bunch of guys on the picture, on the cover, right? There's just no room. Mm-hmm. So the idea that the artist said, well, why don't we just do a whole bunch of hands and feet, right? And then you just see the hands and feet, like, trying to chase after her. Mm-hmm. Like, she's attracting all these bums that are chasing her, right? So the 12 Days of Christmas is the same concept, whereas mm-hmm. you don't see all the guys, but you see the hands with the gifts.
Uh-huh.
So, and those represent the 12 days that she'll meet as she goes through the apartment trying to find her Dave.
It is such a funny, funny, funny tale. So, see, we talked about your upcoming projects and the script writing. Are there any other genres that you're thinking of exploring?
One of the things I am thinking about doing is a cozy mystery, which is very, very different. But J.J. McCall's has a father in the books. He owns a corner store.
Okay.
And so I was really thinking about doing, like, a corner store mystery, Max McCall corner store mystery, mm-hmm. which would center around him, you know, this older guy living in the neighborhood. You know, he's the neighborhood guy, right?
Mm-hmm.
He's the one who knows everybody. And then, like, a murder happens, and then they have to figure out who it is. Mm-hmm. But it happens around his corner store. And of course, he has a daughter that's an FBI agent, mm-hmm. so I can lean on the J.J. McCall story. So that's one of the things that I was really thinking about. That's really, like, out of my realm, mm-hmm. right? So I'd really have to read a lot of cozies to figure out how to piece that story together. But yeah, something that's in the back of my mind. But I have so many projects, you know. Like, I think of a new project, like.
How often do they come to you?
All the time. Mm-hmm. I'm always dreaming things. Mm-hmm. I have a book. When I have an idea, I write down
the idea
mm-hmm. in a book so that I don't lose it. Mm-hmm. Because you just never know when you're going to come back to it. So I probably have about 20 ideas right now floating around in that book.
That's incredible. That's mm-hmm. incredible. You know, I had seen I don't think it was a documentary, but there was a piece that was done about James Patterson and, you know, how he comes up with ideas. And, I mean, he just has file drawers of folders of ideas. I mean, you know, like you, I mean, there's just this forever flowing creative juice that is coming from, oozing from you. And I think that that's a sure sign of your being a writer. And I'm so glad that you didn't allow those naysayers to stop your creativity to the point where it just completely immobilized that process for you. So that's awesome. And I'm sure your fans and readers would agree with that, would definitely agree with that.
Absolutely.
So.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, it's not easy. It really isn't easy. Allowing yourself to be in that creative space without allowing
hearing
the negative
voices,
the chatter impact you. I mean, you're fighting against the negative chatter.
Mm-hmm.
You're fighting against the urge to, like, look at what other authors are doing. And then when you see authors ahead of where you are, you know. But I've just learned, just stay in my lane.
Stay in your lane.
Do what I do. Mm-hmm. I can't focus on what anybody else is doing, and I can't focus on what anybody else says. If I feel good about something when I'm finished, then I feel good about it. Nobody can take that good feeling from me.
Mm-hmm.
I don't allow that.
Yeah.
So I listen to what I want to listen to.
Mm-hmm.
I hear what I want to hear. Not that I drown out all criticism, mm-hmm. but I listen to what I want to listen to, and I listen to what I think is going to be productive, which is going to move me forward. And if I think it's going to stop me or hinder me or move me backwards, I can tune it out. So.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that's really, really important and good advice for those that are listening. You know, you're an accomplished writer, but you came from a place where it was possible that you wouldn't be where you are today. And so for them to hear that, to hear your journey, and then to see your accomplishments, you know, it really kind of makes you want to put your chest out and say, I can do it too. I can do it too.
I really hope, I mean, that's one thing I do hear from other writers, and I hope that my staying engaged and telling people about my journey. Mm-hmm. And I don't just share the good, I share the bad, you know, because a lot of people can be very, you know, my career is all cotton candy and, and dreams and ice cream. And I'm like, no, really.
That's exactly what you envisioned.
No.
I'm living the writer's life.
You know, you know, I'm just clacking away. All those pages are just coming.
Yeah.
Everything's a bestseller. No, it doesn't really happen that way for everybody.
It's like then the reality comes crashing down. So that's good. Well, thank you again for sharing your artistry with us.
Thank you.
You're awesome.
Thank you. I appreciate you for having me.
Absolutely. And you'll be back. You'll be back when you're ready to drop that next book.
Yes,
We'll pick this up again. Well, Dreamcatchers, join me next time in The Haven when I'm joined by the incomparable Tina McElroy Anza. She's the New York Times bestselling author of Baby and the Family, Ugly Ways, The Hand I Fan With, and she talks about her newest projects, From Here On Out and Secrets of a Bogart Queen. She's my author crush, and it's going to be hard to keep it together, so you don't want to miss that. Don't forget to catch us and subscribe to our YouTube channel and stream us on iTunes, Spotify, iHeartRadio, Sonos, SoundCloud, Alexa, and Spreaker. And until next time, catch fire on purpose. Dreamcatchers, welcome to another exciting season of The Writer's Haven Show. I'm V Helena, your host and executive producer. The Writer's Haven Show was created to showcase the passion, process, and projects of writers of literature, television, and film. In our third season, we've expanded our programming to include songwriters. We hope to inspire and motivate you with this season's lineup of artists. Stream our shows on iHeartRadio, Spreaker, iTunes, Sonos, SoundCloud, Spotify, Alexa, and YouTube. We drop new episodes every week, so subscribe and never miss a show. Find me on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and Tumblr at Author V Helena, and visit our website at www.writershavenshow.com. See you in the Haven, and until next time, catch fire on purpose.
The color in my garden keeps the pink of my cheeks. I was very independent and thought I could take care of myself. I fell and I had to have Meals on Wheels. They're my savior. My name is Lola Silvestri. America, let's do lunch.
Drop off a hot meal and say hello. Volunteer by donating your lunch break at americaletsdolunch.org.
Look at you. You're at the top of your game. You're unstoppable. Nothing can throw you off track. Wait, is that your car? Uh-oh. Yeah, I saw that coming. That will throw you off track. You're looking at around 10 grand in fines, legal fees, and increased insurance rates. Let's try this again. Smart move. Because buzz driving is drunk driving.